Hello everyone. So welcome to the third video on the machine learning. So yeah, so as part of this video, so in the last two videos we kind of covered what is intro to machine learning. We also covered some of the topics like regression and how do we play around regression in Python. So these are the topics we covered. So in this particular video, I would like to cover an important concept in machine learning, which is classification. It's slightly different from how we treat regression to classification. Still, they both are supervised learning techniques. But if a problem statement was given to us, the way we approach a regression problem is quite different from the way we approach a classification problem. So the classification, when we talk about it, clearly says that we would classify. So before getting into the classification topics, there are a few topics that, you know, we have to cover in regression. It's like advanced part of the linear regression that we can talk about. So I would like to cover that, and then I will take the video to, you know, I will take the next part of the video to the classification techniques, and we can just end it up there. So yeah, the next part of the regression that I was talking about is a polynomial regression. So till this point, we spoke about what is linear regression. So the name itself, I think you can understand. So polynomial in the sense that you're not fitting a linear line anymore, like y equal to mx plus c. You don't fit a linear line anymore, and you try to fit a polynomial. It could be of any degree, like a degree 2 or degree 3. So it could be it could be of any degree, but you try to fit that polynomial to your regression technique and you will get to see the data. So what it is, and when we do the polynomial regression, where does this feature scaling come into the picture, and how does feature scaling would help us? So let's cover that first, and then we'll move to the classification part. We'll understand what is logistic regression. That is, in order to understand the classification problem, we need to understand how the classification actually works, you know, in a real-time scenarios. And we'll also work on the gradient descent that we spoke in linear regression, how it turned out in logistic regression. I mean, there is not much difference in terms of the way algorithm works. It's just that there is a little bit of change in the equation. So how do we do? We'll see that. And we'll talk about an interesting and an important concept called overfitting in all this data. So that's very important that we should talk about. And how do we prevent overfitting? So we use regularization. So we'll talk about what is regularization as well. So this is how we'll take it up. And yeah, so if we, so in for feature scaling, so if we see any kind of a simple code on internet, we see something called as scaling. So before we pass the input parameters to the model, we do a step called scaling. So what is that, and why we are doing it, and how does it help, you know, in gradient descent? What exactly is mean normalization? So if you go to any kind of interview, people might ask you, like, what is normalization? What is mean normalization? Why do we have to do this normalization? Why do we have to do this feature scaling? And they both are like similar kind of steps, but you know, we can actually do both of them, or, you know, you can do one or other. But the importance of doing these steps is to actually play around with the input data. But why do we need it? So let's get into that. Yeah. So the polynomial regression, fitting a curve instead of a line. For example, we have a line. We have the line equation. We know that y equal to mx plus c, which is of the form w0 plus w1x. But if you want to fit a curve, the equation would be slightly different. So y cap equal to w0 plus w1x plus w2x square plus w3x cube. And it keeps going based on, you know, how your model identifies the values. So if you clearly see the way that we look at the equation. So let's say I have a data which is of this form. Okay, so let's assume we have some data which is of this form, and till now what we are doing is we are trying to fit a line. But what happens is, this is our prediction. Whatever the black I am drawing is our y prediction or y hat. And whatever the green values we have, they are all y, the original values. So if we were to find the error, the difference between these two is slightly big, right? So the error would be a little bit more. So if I do the prediction at this particular point, I would get this value instead of this value. So what would people do? Instead of fitting, this is all because we are trying to fit a line. What if we try to fit a curve? So if we try to fit a curve, then it would be something like this, right? So it might create a confusion, so let me just erase the part that this is why it is not. So these are my original values, and this curve would be our curve fit. So if you try to fit a curve, then it would be like this, and the equation of this curve would be y cap equal to w0 plus w1x plus w2x square. So we have x square term. And for example, if we have a different kind of curve where we have input data to be something like this, let's assume we have input data to be like this, and the way that we have to fit the curve now would change. So it would go something like this. So in this case, our equation would be something like y cap equal to w0 plus w1x plus w2x plus w3x square, w3x cube, and it goes on. So when you increase more data points, when then there is a slight bit of, you know, a pattern change in data points, then the equation would certainly change. Would, you know, we have more number of x parameters that would keep, and the cube, the power 4, and it might be x power 5. So it keeps increasing. So that's how, that is called polynomial regression. So where does this scaling part comes into the picture? So what is scaling? What happens in scaling? So we have our input parameter. So let's get back here. So we have our input to be going like x cube, x power 4, and x power 5. If we reiterate the concepts that we spoke in, regression part, we have something called, let's reiterate the example that we spoke in regression part. So there is something called house prediction. So we have taken the square feet of the house across which we have considered what is the price of the house. If we reiterate the values of the square feet of the house, they are in like 1600 square feet, 1200 square feet, 1300 square feet. So the values are not quite big. So if you try to plug in those values in your equation, what happens is, so the equation would certainly change. So let's assume that we have a case where our input is, let's take a case where I have this kind of data, and where the prediction house values would be 1200 square feet, 1300 square feet, and 1600 square feet, and it goes on like it goes. So there are a lot of values before 1200, right? Like 0, 1, 2, but you don't find all those values. So if you really draw it for origin, instead of doing it, wherever we want. So if we really try to pin it for origin, what happens is, if you see the curve, so it would be something like this. So if it might start here at origin, and if you go on, so the values all would be residing somewhere in here. Right. So you don't find values in here near to it, and you find all of them to be somewhere residing here. And the x-axis would be your square feet of the house, and the house would be price. Okay. So here, what's happening is, when you try to write the equation for this, it would be y cap equal to w0 plus w1 into probably 1600. Plus W2 into 1300 whole square plus W3 into probably 1200 whole cube, and W4 into probably 1800 whole power 4. So, you know, it keeps increasing. The value of X that you are taking here, you know, you are trying to compute it over 1800 whole power 4. When we do this, this will have direct impact on the gradient descent. So our weights that we are trying to compute from J of W, if we reiterate the J of W equation from, you know, from the linear regression part, we have the X term in our gradient descent part. So when we try to, you know, put these values in our gradient descent equation, so the concept of the gradient going down would eventually impact. And if we don't do it, so even the equation when we are trying to compute here would scale it up, and 1800 whole power 4 is quite big. I mean, in this case, it's just 1800. If you take a slightly different example where you might have price on your x-axis, then the price values could be $80,000, it could be $90,000, and it could be anything. So in that, it would be 90,000 whole power 4, and the scale would shoot up. So to avoid this, we need to do a scaling on the input. So all these 1600, 1200, 1300 is our X parameters, right? So we need to scale them. Scaling in the sense, we need to bring those values to one particular range, probably between 0 to 1. Or you can also bring them to a smaller numbers. Probably you can do a kind of subtraction. I mean, there are methods, there are a lot of methods to do, you know, feature scaling part. So you can all, you know, subtract certain amount from them, which is what we call mean normalization. So what we do is we take the highest number, like probably, you know, if we have all these values, let's take the highest is 1800, and least is like, you know, least lowest value is like 1200. Then we kind of take all the values between 1800 and 1200, and we divide them by the difference between these two. Okay, so if we do that, we kind of get one type of scaling factor. So we'll divide all of them with the difference between these two. That's one way to do it. And the other way is to actually subtract, you know, mean from all the values. So we try to compute the mean of, you know, all the given data, and we'll subtract the mean from each of the data. Then what happens when we do this, all the values that were concentrated here, when we subtract the mean, they come towards. So they all would shift here. So this is called mean normalization. We even call it mean shifting as well. So we are shifting the mean from one place to the origin, so that the points would concentrate across the origin. So I mean, this is probably because you are trying to decrease the values of 1600, 1700, 1800 to the values of 0, 1, 2 to this range. So this is probably one of the most important, you know, steps we should take when we are trying to run any model. So these are some of the practical issues that we come across when you are trying to implement the things like regression. So especially in terms of polynomial regression, where you have the input to be squared, cubed, you know, and to the power of 4. So in these cases, you definitely need some kind of scaling. And it could be mean normalization. It could be, you know, simply subtracting the highest value from all the lowest value, or the mean value from all of the values. So you can do any kind of steps. If you look at, you know, the scaling things we have in our Python also, you can come across a lot of the way that you scale the things. You can do it manually. You can use already, you know, available scaling. Scaling syntax that is available. We can use them as well. But the importance of this step, and I'm just reiterating the fact that it is so very important when we are doing in real world problems, because the input could be of any value. And without scaling, if we try to, you know, run the model, then the gradient descent, in order to converge, it will take huge amount of time, and it might even shoot up at some points. And also when we try to do some kind of analysis on the data as well, it wouldn't be of great help if we are trying to do it over whole power 5 or whole power 6. So feature scaling is quite very important in our general day-to-day machine learning things. You could do regression, you could do classification, wherever you are using in algorithms like gradient descent, or wherever you are trying to fit the data to a curve based polynomial. I mean, you'll fit the data in polynomial in regression, and you will kind of draw a line or draw a boundary to separate two different classes in classification. So still you are drawing something there, a line or a curve or where it is. So when we have that, the scaling is quite important. So people might ask you in the interviews as well, like, why is scaling, what is mean normalization, why we do it and things like that. Please, we should be very clear, like, why we need to do this. I mean, if you are trying to solve only real world problems, we'll understand why scaling is needed. So what's we are done with the regression now, and we'll talk about the classification. So if we reiterate the fact of what is doing, what is happening in the regression, we are trying to predict the values. So based on the input, we'll try to predict, okay, this might be here, this might be here, like that. When it comes to classification, it is slightly different. We don't predict, you know, what is the value, but we kind of try to predict where it goes in, like which class it might go into. Let's take for example you have a thing where you are trying to list the prices on your we'll just take the same problem. We'll try to get the square feet of the house on the x-axis and the price on the y-axis, but we don't say price, we call it high or low price. Only two variables, low price, high price. Okay. So if we generally consider in our day-to-day, let's take the ideal scenario where we have the square feet, you know, going across the values of the square feet of the house, you know, going. And if you see less square feet, you have points to be, you know, on the lower side. I have considered all the low. As the square feet increasing, we have high price. I don't want to name the price, I just want to take it into low price house and high price house based on the square feet. So we have this kind of technique. I mean, we are only saying whether it is low or high, we are not telling the price. So the low is just one value. So in classification, what we do is we kind of try to put the values into two different classes. So let's take some value, whether I want to put it into low class or high class. So low price class or high price class. So that is the kind of, you know, scenario we'll come across. In this case, previously our y values would be numerical values. Here they would be binary. So our y will take only 0 or 1. When I say 0, it's, you know, probably the low price class. When I say 1, it's probably the high price class. So this is how we differentiate in classification. So when this is happening, how do we, you know, classify these two things? Let's say I try to fit a line, just like I'm trying to fit a line in our regression technique. Let us assume we are trying to fit a line for the given classification problem. If I try to draw a line here, you know, let's assume that in just like in regression, we try to draw a line here as well. So in this case, what happens is we drew a line and we are trying to make sure we will put some kind of threshold on top of it let's assume this is, you know, mid between, let's assume this is average between high price and low price. And if the values that fall, you know, below this particular value, we would consider them as, you know, all to be low. And if I say whether they are above this point, we'll consider all of them to be high. Okay, so this is how we are, I mean, low or zero, I mean, I would consider this as zero plus, high or plus one. So let's assume if you want to fit a line to the classification in order to make sure that to separate two different things, this is what happens. So we'll try to make sure that we'll draw a line, we will put some threshold on top of it. If the values are below 0.5 our y cap, then we would consider all those values to be, you know, zero. If those are above 0.5, we'll consider values to be one. Okay, so let's assume that it is simply the values that are being on other side of the curve, other side of the line, I want to consider them in one class. The ones which are below the other, I want to put it in another class. Let us assume we have a case where we got values to be something like this. Okay. Right? We have square feet values going something like this. So in this case, what happens is if you try to fit a line exactly the way we are doing before, this particular point that we are trying to do would come under low price, but it is not, because the ones which are above the line we consider them as one class, the ones which are below line we consider them as the other class, right? So but when we actually try to fit a line for this problem, so this would eventually drop out from the things. But when we do it, you know, when we slightly try to get the line, you know, towards this direction or something like that, even then the concept of, you know, separating two classes with respect to a line certainly fails. So then what we should do? So the binary class, if you want to address the binary classification problem, y cap of y should be 0 or 1. So assuming h of x to be w0 plus w1x, h of x is the y cap that we are talking about. Let's call this with some function h of x. So if we assume h of x to be w0 plus w1x, the ones that we are reiterating, if we try to fit a line for the classification classes that we have, then the concept of, you know, doing a classification with respect to fitting a line for two different classes and putting a threshold on top of it wouldn't really work. And one more thing is, so if we want to do this, we have to make sure that h of x that we have should be either low or high, or should be the value between 0 to 1, right? So these values that we are talking about are h of x, and these values are x simply. I mean, h of x is nothing but a prediction, right? So it is quite a fact that the value should be between 0 and 1. Since we are considering low as 0 and high price as 1, so the values of h of x should be 0, between 0 and 1. But if you consider price values, they will be 80,000, 90,000, and if you consider any kind of classification also, the price would be totally different. So now what we should do? We need to make sure the values of h of x, whatever they could be, they have to come into one range of 0 to 1. So always the h of x in classification should be 0 less than or equal to h of x less than or equal to 1. So this condition has to satisfy, because if you want to put them, because h of x is nothing but our y cap. Since our original y stays between 0 and 1, or takes the values of 0 or 1, our h of x should also be between the range of 0 less than or equal to h of x less than or equal to 1, right? So this h of x is nothing but our y cap. So if we just go into a little bit more, the decision boundary need not have to be a straight line, as we discussed before. So the decision boundary that we are trying to separate between two classes, it will never be a straight line, or it need not have to be a straight line. It should be a curve, or it should be more of like a different kind of a decision boundary to separate two different classes. So for example, let's take, we have a case where we have classes to be something like this. And we have another class to be, you know, something like this. So these are like two different classes. So, I mean, in some problem, we have two different classes. Then how do you separate these two classes? So if you try to fit a line here, you know, you cannot actually fit a line. So you cannot draw something like this or like this, you know, or, you know, maybe even if you try to do some of them. So let's assume that you try to fit this line. If you try to fit this line, some of the points of this class would be considered on the other side of the line, which is like wrong. So fitting a line would never work. Then what we should do? We should ideally go for a scenario where we don't have a line, but a different kind of, you know, separation boundary. So how does that work? something like this.
So this would be our decision boundary.
Decision boundary.
So in if we compare with regression, so we are trying to fit a line to the points that are available in the given data. But when it comes to the classification, we try to draw a boundary across the points. Then we try to separate the ones that are falling below the decision boundary. I would term it as one class. And the points that are above the decision boundary, I would term it as another class. So we will try to do this when we are doing the classification techniques. But how does this, you know, the equation of this line would look? Right, ideally, this is not a straight line. So our h of x, the one that we are taking here, would no longer be a w0 or w1x. It will be w0 plus w1x plus w2x square. It could be any, it could be, you know, it could keep going. So that's where I want to, you know, address the fact that if I put three dots or four dots of w0 plus w1x, I mean to say that it's not a w0 plus w1x a single line, it's a polynomial. So I mean, that's the kind of representation that I'm following, just to make sure, you know, you don't get confused with w0 plus w1x is not just a single line. It does mean that it is a curve. So the decision boundary that we are talking here. Okay, so this is the kind of line that we need in our this is the kind of curve. Sorry, this is the kind of curve that we need in order to separate two classes in when it comes to the classification. So this is a classification problem. So when we were given two different classes, for example, let's take, you know, dog and cat class. So we'll first try to convert these dog and cat images into these kind of, you know, class related you know, things, data points. Once we do this, we try to fit a line. We try to fit a decision boundary on top of this, where we try to say that the points which are falling below the decision boundary comes into one class, and the points that are above the boundary would, you know, fall in a different class. So that is the kind of technique that we are following here, and that is probably the classification. So we are trying to say, so we probably say this as, you know, class 0, and we call it as class 1. So we'll try to put this point into class 0 or class 1. So when a new data comes into the picture, for example, let's take I have got a new data, and the data will, So let's take I have got a new data, probably a point somewhere in here. So I term this as class 0, and maybe I got a new data, you know, falling somewhere in here. Then I term this as class 1. That's how we do it, a classification technique. So this is like training data. Based on the training data, we will fit a line, and when we get the next test data, we will try to put that data here, and we will try to say if they are falling in class 0, we'll say class 0. If they are falling in class 1, we'll say class 1. So that is called classification technique. Yeah, so as we already discussed, so in order to achieve this part, the h of x, whatever we are doing, it should be between 0 and 1, ideally. Because we want to say whether it is class 0 or class 1. The value should fall in between certain spaces where it should take the values of 0 or 1, because our y is actually 0 or 1. So eventually, at the end of the day, whatever the x value is, I would say y is class C, y is to be 0 or 1. So I mean, mainly, at least when you are considering a binary classification, I mean, when we have, you know, when we want to get into three classes or four classes, we'll have y taking values 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like that. 0 to be class 0, 1 to be class 1, like that. But when we actually talk about in a general sense, in a binary sense, y would take value 0 or 1. So if y, the original y, takes 0 or 1, our prediction h of x should also stay between 0 and 1. Right? So, I mean, If it stays between 0 and 1, we will probably put a threshold and say, you know, something less than 0.5, I will, you know, make sure it is 0. If something above 0.5, I will make sure we'll put some kind of threshold. You know, that is, putting a threshold is secondary. But initially, it should be between 0 and 1 to put the threshold. So we need to make all the points should be between that values. Okay, so this is our z, actually. You know, something, it's not printed here.
inform me about that, but it's actually Z.
And with Z of Z equal to 120. So to do this, what we are doing here? So the Z of Z that we are talking about here is simply a sigmoid function. I mean, if you are into machine learning, at least if you have, you know, started as an intro, as if you look into any of the blocks, you might have heard about something called a sigmoid function. So what is sigmoid function? So it simply is a function where you have the curve to be. So this is, let's assume this is your Z values, okay, and your minus C right here. So let's say this is 0.5. And the curve would be something like this. So this is our, so this is 1, and where it goes into 1, and this is our 0. Okay. So this is how the curve of the sigmoid actually looks. So what is happening here? So the values that are below 0.5, or h of c that would be below 0.5, they all, you know, would be falling for the negative set of the data. And the ones which are above 0, or, you know, above 0, they, I mean, the ones that are positive values, they all take the values that are above 0.5. So the ones that are negative would take values below 0.5. The ones that are positive would take values above 0.5. So, which means that if something falls above 0.5, I would term it as plus 1. That is positive. If some value falls below 0.5, I would term it as plus 0. You know, that is negative. But why don't we do, so some might ask, like, why only this? Why not something like this? You know, and putting a line like this, and, you know, probably differentiating at this point and saying, this is not ideally a correct way, because the way that we are drawing this distribution, the exponential, we are trying to fit in all the values of h of x to g. So whatever the h of x we have in our previous thing, the w0 plus w1x, now we'll take this w0 w1x plus w2x square, whatever we have, and on top of that we will apply g of w0, which means that whatever the values that we get from, you know, h of x by computing that, we will apply a sigmoid on top of it. So let's say we got, you know, some value to be you know, some 100 or something like that. When we put that in this equation, it will bring that value to somewhere between 0 and 1. So that is the sole intention of doing this. And if we, you know, reiterate the fact that we should have h of x should be 0 and 1, the values of h of x could be of any range, but we will try to fit that range to an exponential data or exponential equation, which is a sigmoid equation. That is g of z equal to 1 by 1 plus e power minus c. So this would be a part of our classification technique, where before applying the decision making, we should make sure that our h of x would actually get into the 1 by 1 plus e power minus c, or it should take the values of 1 by 1 plus e power minus c. So it could be of any range, but all the range of h of x would fall in between these values. And now it is easy to classify. Once they fall in between these values, we'll say, okay, what all the values that we have below 0.5, I would name it as class 0. What all the values that are above 0.5, I would name it as class 1. So that is the kind of an approach we follow when it comes to the classification. Yeah. So let's see the cost function. So if for the logistic regression, if we see the cost function for logistic regression, it would be of this form: y log of h of x plus 1 minus y log of 1 minus h of x. This seems to be a little bit different from what we have seen in regression. So if we consider the cost function in linear regression, it would be simply an MSC. But in this case, the cost function is slightly different. But if we, let's, I mean, seems to be a little bit tricky, but if we try to, you know, just understand what we are doing here, it's quite simple. The idea is to just make sure the cost, or whatever the error, the cost that we are talking about is simply the error, right? So the error should be minimum, right? So that's the, in fact, that is the case. So let's assume whatever the y that we have in here, that is the original y, I mean the values that y actually takes. So what are the values that y takes? Y might take 0, y might take 1. So if y is 0 in this equation, let's put y as 0. If y is 0 in this equation, then it would be log of the our cost would be j of w, j our cost. I don't call it j of w. I just want to call it cost. Our cost would be simply, you know, log of 1 minus h of x. Don't forget the fact that our h of x is g of w0 plus w1x plus and so on. So g is sigmoid function. I just want to reiterate because we might, you know, lost in the loop. So our h of x is the prediction that we are taking. So the cost would be log of 1 minus h of x. When we take y equal to 1, the cost would be log of h of x. Right? So what is happening here is, let's assume the h of x values will be between again 0 and 1. Right? So if h of x is 0, okay, let's assume in both the cases, if h of x is 0, log 0 is infinity and log 1 is 0. Right? Log 1 is 0. So your cost is 0, so as your y. Right? So when your cost is 0, which means that you are trying to have a minimum error. Right? So the cost is nothing but your error. Your error is 0. And when y equal to 0, your error is 0. And that is fine. But your y equal to 1 would have the error to be infinity. Right? So that means that it's not y equal to 1 class. It's y equal to 0 class when cost equal to 0. When you have h of x equal to 0. Right? Let's consider h of x to be 1. If I consider h of x to be 1, log of 1 minus 1, which is log 0, which means that cost is infinity, right? And when I consider this log 1, it is simply 0. So the cost is 0 when h of x is 1 and y equal to 1, right? So I'll just write it down here. So if h of x equal to 0, cost at y equal to 0 would be 0. And if h of x equal to 1, cost at y equal to 1 would also be 0, which means that the error is 0 when y equal to 1, h of y equal to 1. H of x equal to 1. So y and h of x are simply the predictions. H of x is prediction and y is original. So I mean, h of x is taking the values of y when the error is 0. So that's what is happening. So if h of x is 0, cost at y equal to 0 would be 0. If you consider cost at y equal to 1, it would be infinity, which means that it is not a class that you should pick. If error is infinity, means error is very large. If error is 0, then I would say y equal to 0 and h of x equal to 0. So that is a kind of iteration we should consider, and that is a kind of, you know, the way that we should reiterate the fact why we are taking this equation is because we want to pick our values to be something like this. I hope I'm clear. If we have any questions, we'll discuss more in Q&A, but please make sure that the equation that we are taking here is simply because we want to reiterate the fact that if h of x taking the values of the 0, our y also should be 0, and at this point of time the error should be 0. If our h of x is taking the values of the 1, then our cost at that particular point should be 0, where our y also takes the values of 1. Yes, so that's where we have this equation. Okay, so when we apply the gradient descent, so I mean the gradient descent would never change, that it would still be, you know, learning rate into dou of j of w by dou w, and it would be the updation. But here the h of x that we are taking here would actually be g of w0 plus w1x plus w2x. So it continues, where g of z is our 1 by 1 plus e power minus c. A dou of dw by dou w. This is just that, you know, w1, w2, I just want to say that is iterating over j. Yeah, so the gradient descent that we are talking would never change, but the h of x would change. it will, the gradient descent will still be a parabola, you know, I mean, when we are talking about, it's not a parabola, but when you are talking about, it will still be a curve, and you know, where the weight initialization will start, the learning rate has to be low, and the descent usually follows the, you know, the curve, and this, the whole process would still remain same. The curves might be different, and you know, the way that we talk about global minima, global maxima, they all remain same, and the way we do weight initialization, everything remains same with respect to gradient descent. But the h of x that we are taking here is no longer a w0 plus w1x, but it is a w0 plus w1x plus w2x square plus and so on top of it, where we have a sigmoid function. So this would be our h of x. So if we reiterate, you know, again, compare it to our general linear regression for gradient descent, the process again is completely same. So the learning rate, choosing the, so here what happens, we are trying to update the values of the weights just based on the gradient descent, and we are putting them back into the equation. We are drawing a decision boundary. So I mean, in this case also, the decision boundaries initial could be, you know, something like this. Again, it, you know, it might be like this. And if, so as weights get updated, it will take the values of this when we have, you know, classes of different on the either sides of the case. So the process would remain the same, but still the way that we are you know, looking at h of x would change. Yeah, so the way that we are updating this would still remain same. I just left this because I wanted to just show if someone missed the first video. So I mean, when we talk about the gradient descent, we have, you know, the curve something like this, and we want to understand how the gradient descent works. So in that is the case, what happens is weight initialization would happen here. So this is our W and this is our J of W. So if we try to start with some weight initialization, it starts here, and as we keep decreasing our learning rate, our gradient descent would go down. As it goes down, it will update the values of our weights. It will do the weight updation, and it will again, you know, get to the new weight values, and it will keep going. It will keep going. At some point, it will reach its minimum, you know, where it will not update anymore. And that's where we say our cost has reached its zero point. And those are the weights that we would consider in our equation. So this is what happens. And in this case, sometimes what happens is when we have a curve to be something of this form. So sometimes what happens is when our gradient descent starts here, it might struck here and it will never reach this point. This is called local optimum. We'll call it local optimum or local minimum. So it will struck at this local minimum, but it will never reach global minimum. So this process happens when we choose learning rate to be very low or something like that. For that, we introduce the concepts of the momentum or something like that, where we push the learning rate a little bit more. And one more concept we do is weight initialization. So instead of starting the weights here, we might start weights here. So this is like, you know, zero, starting the weights at zero. And when we start here, it's random initialization. So random initialization might be, you know, give you a global, you know, minimum instead of giving it a local minimum. It's all depends on, you know, the way that we choose the weights. And so I'm just reiterating this fact because someone might miss the first video. So overfitting, it's pretty straightforward concept. So in this equation, in this particular data, we have points to be like this, and we are fitting a line. And when we have points like this, we are trying to fit a curve. And we have, for the same points, we are trying to fit a more advanced curve. So in this case, we call it this as underfit. We call this as overfit. And we call this as, you know, perfect fit. Okay. Why we are calling this as overfit? So in this case, we are trying to pass through each and every point of the given data. So in this case, what happens is when we actually have, you know, the values to be coming up here, they fall here. And we have here, they fall here. So this particular, in this particular case, the data that we are having would work exceptionally well on training data, would exceptionally work well on training data. So this is all training data. But when it sees the new data, it fails because it is just, you know, overfitted to the training data. But the test data could be totally different. It fails on test data. But when we take the perfect fit, it will work. It will not work extremely well on training data, but it will never fail on test data. So it will give an optimum accuracy. So when we keep the training, you know, keeps going in terms of, when we don't stop the training at some point, the curve which started at, you know, y equal to w0 plus w1x would take the shape of y equal to w0 plus w1x plus w2x square, and it will take the values of w0 plus w1x plus w2x square plus w3x cube, and it keeps going. So this is the reason that we have overfitting. So early stopping is what we say, you know, when we want to avoid. So we want to stop it somewhere in here. How do we know that? I mean, it's practically not easy for us to identify where to stop, but eventually we should stop at this point, which is quite difficult to do. So that's where we propose the concept of regularization. So what is regularization? So we'll look into that. So the point is, this is this curve that we are fitting here in the third case, the curve that we are fitting here, this is purely the overfitted curve. So when we have, so the same happens when we have classification also. So let's take a case where I have a decision boundary to be, I have class structure to be something like this, and I have, you know, values to be like this. So in this case, a decision boundary of, you know, this form would actually help. But when you do the overfitting, the decision boundary would change to be something like this. Okay, so this particular way of differentiating the things, or I mean, when you this is even, you know, this is not a good example to talk about. Okay, let's do one thing. I will just make sure we have more concrete data to, you know, justify my fact. So let's take, I have class values to be like this. So if we want to fit a decision boundary, how do we fit is? So we want to make sure that all these would come under one point, right? So we will do like this. This is the kind of decision boundary we'll take. I mean, the ones that are after decision boundary will be one more. So this is kind of overfitting. So this would never help. So if you want to fit a perfect decision boundary, then it should be of something like this, right? This is a perfect. I mean, there could be few errors, but we cannot do. I mean, these are the only point that may, you know, go out of the bounds, but that is fine. Instead of putting this kind of curve where the decision boundary is completely, you know, changed, that would have serious impact on the kind of test data that we see. So this is the kind of overfitting that we see in the classification techniques. So how do we avoid it? We have a thing called as regularization. So what is with the regularization? Sigma over J and WJ. J is nothing but it is, I'm just saying here, the regularization term would be lambda into W1 square plus W2 square plus W3 square, things like that. Okay. So, yeah, this is okay. So this term we will add it to our equation. Okay. So why adding this term would have a serious impact?
So what is regularization? Let me just do it. W j whole square sigma j sigma over j is what I wanted to do. Okay. So what is regularization? So here, if we look at this, W3x cube plus W4x power 4, this is how our equation looks. And if we clearly see, the terms W3x cube and W4x power 4 are the reason that we have this kind of fit. If we try to remove these two terms, then the things still would be here, the same, right? So whatever the values that we have in here, we need to make sure that this would eventually go down. The W3x cube plus W4x power 4. How this happens? By making W3 value to be 0 and by making W4 value to be 0. I mean, not 0, but close to 0. This is what we should do in order to make sure that this equation would turn to, you know, W0 plus W1x plus W2x square. So how do we do it? It's simply that we add this term to our cost function. That is lambda into W3 square plus W4 square plus W5 square and things like that. But why adding this term to cost would give a huge impact? Because what we are doing here is we are trying to make sure the cost function to be minimized. So when we want to make sure this is minimized, we eventually decrease the values of the W3, W4, W5. Because the lambda that we choose would be somewhere in the ranges of 1000, you know, or you know, could be of 10,000 or something like that. So when we have the values of 1000 or 10,000, our J of W would change something like J of W equal to our regular equation. This, you know, this equation would come here plus it would be 1000 W3 square plus 1000 W4 square and things like that. So when this keeps going, what eventually the cost function would do is, I mean, when we are trying to minimize it, it will eventually push our W3 and W4 to be zero. Because since we have a huge scalar here multiplying with the W3 values, the cost function when we are trying to minimize, it will eventually push the values of W3 and W4 to be zero. So when we eventually push these values to zero, the ones that we are trying to build from cost function. So once we get the cost function, we will get the h of x equation, right? The ones that we are, the hypothesis equation. So this equation we are trying to build itself, we are trying to make sure we will remove W3 and this equation we are trying to build itself, we will remove W3 and W4 by making sure that our cost function would never take the values of W3 and W4. So that is the concept of the regularization. So we add this regularization term next to our cost function equation and we'll choose an optimal lambda so that the values would, you know, eventually go down. And choosing a lambda is also key. I mean, choosing high values of the lambda would eventually bring the underfitting factor. I mean, we are making, if we put a bigger lambda, then it might even decrease our values of W1 and W2 also. Right. I mean the ones which are, then again we will get a straight line in our equation instead of having a curve. So we should make sure that our lambda would choose a particular value, but not very high, not too low, to make sure the high weights that we are talking about, which are having CS impact, like the weights that are taking, you know, the terms of highest polynomials like x power 4, x power 5, should go to minimum. So that is the intention of adding a regularization. So when we add regularization, our curve would not take random shapes. It would take a simple shape of like this or, you know, somewhat better. So that is the intention of adding the regularization. So, yeah. So I think I'm done. So just to recollect the fact, the classification technique is just to classify two different classes. We have classes to be class 0, class 1. And if you want to do multi-class classification, we'll have more than one or two classes, whether you have class 3, class 4. And in that case, what we do is we can do one versus, you know, all classifications. So first we will classify class 0 and all classes, all the other classes, we'll name it as one class. And then after classifying class 0, we then take the other classes and then we will again apply binary classification on those.
again we'll do it. So that's one way of doing, you know, one versus all classification. So multi-classification has many techniques. I mean, as we as we look into the fact, as we take somewhat advanced version of it, and we have many other ways to address this fact. But ideally, this is what happens. And also, there is so in the classification, it's quite different from the way we see it in regression. The cost function changes, but the way that we approach the local or global minima, global minima would still remain the same. The gradient descent would still remain the same. It will still be the same, the curve where it starts and it keeps going down. It's just that our h of x would no longer be a simple, double zero plus double one x, but it will take the values of the sigmoid function. So this is basically, we call it logistic regression. The name might be different. The name might follow the linear regression part, but don't get confused. Logistic regression is simply a classification. You can remember with the fact that log we have here, logistic log. So we are fitting log terminology in here. And log terminology, when we fit in here, we are trying to make sure that it's a classification. And since we want to put a threshold, we are doing a log in here. I mean, the derivation part of this particular equation, arriving at this particular equation, is a bit big, and it's purely math related, and I did not do it here because, some might feel, and I want to do it, keep it just, too basic. So that's the reason, not get into so much of the math. But if you want to, get into that, I can suggest some of the Andrew NG videos I followed. I got completely inspired by him, and the way that I approach this course is also, quite similar to the way that he is doing. So, but he has more math derivations and things like that. If you want to get into that, you can go to YouTube and you can, just type logistic regression by Andrew NG. Probably you'll get a few different videos on how he's trying to do the derivation, and you can also find some of the else videos as well. But derivation part is important, but understanding why we got this logistic regression equation and how we are trying to get this hypothesis to be done is the key. So probably we'll have QA session by today, Friday, right? So we'll have by today evening, and you can all raise your questions and doubts. Sorry that there is a slight delay from the previous video, kind of little occupied with my office work, so pardon me with that, but still we can do it by today evening from 7 to 8. I think we already had the call meeting invite, so you can join there, and I hope to see you all there. Okay then.